afternoon, everyone. It is good to be here today. We're a bit short people up here. We're short Rabbi, Miss Catherine, and some others, but I'm sure that God is still in the house. Amen. And we're going to gather together this morning and give glory and honor to our King with all of our hearts, because He is worthy. He's worthy of our praises. He's worthy of our adoration. He's the beginning and the end. He's the Alpha and the Omega, and He never changes. And it's good to fellowship. It's good to pray together, to worship together. And it's important because we're stronger as a community. We're stronger as a community than we are alone. Scripture says where there are two or more people gathered together, God is in the midst of us. And if you just want to look around, be thinking about all the people that you know that aren't here, be praying for them so they're here in our thoughts. And I just wanted to make mention that Robert Rinder, he's at 669 at the Towers at Sacred Heart, if anyone wants to come visit him. I know a lot of us are struggling and hurting and going through various trials. But I'm telling you that Yeshua, He wants to take all of our burdens from us, and He wants to take all of that pain and all of that hurt. He wants to give us peace, and He wants to restore us. His light, restores us, it cleanses us, and it makes us free. So many of us have hearts that are heavy and weighed down with all kinds of baggage that we hold on to, but we don't have to hold on to that. We don't have to hold on to that baggage. So this morning, let's just work on releasing all of that stuff that's weighing us down, and just give it all to Yeshua. If you all would like to rise as we prepare for praise and worship, we read in the songs, sing to the Lord a new song, sing it to the Lord. All of earth, sing to the Lord, praise His name, proclaim His salvation day after day. Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous deeds among the peoples. So let's just rise up and proclaim His victory over our hearts, over our lives, victory over death, victory over oppression and over depression, victory over the enemy. And let's praise Him from our whole hearts, from the very depths of our souls. Amen?
Thank you.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, from the house of God. open to me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them. I will praise the Lord. Oh Lord, I beseech you.
Breathe on me, brother God. you have answered me, and you have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is from the Lord, and it is marvelous in your eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. O Lord, save us, we pray. We beseech you, O Lord, cause us to prosper.
I'm
Start the liturgy. I want to make just a few, ask a few questions and announcements. If you were here earlier, Robert Rector's in the hospital. hands earlier if you're going to be here Monday night. Don't lift them up now. But if you weren't here earlier and you're going to be here Monday night for the Chinese food night, can you raise your hands? Did you raise it earlier? Okay, raise your hand. One, two. How many are talking about there? Five of you? Five, okay, six. I see you. Seven, eight. The back nine. How many we got there? Three, 12. Up to 12. I think that's it. 12 more, Robin. Okay. All right. Oh, make it 13, 14, 15. 15. Okay. Add 20. All right. We'll all rise and we'll start our liturgical service here. Page 39 and 40. From Shop to Mind. And with joy shall draw forth water from the fountains of salvation.
Who shall tell my blessed soul?
Sabbath day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God, and if you shall not do any work.
For in 6 days the Lord made
also unto the children of Israel, saying, above all, my Sabbaths you shall keep. For it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord, to sanctify you. Amen. They shall move. The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord. They shall move, the name is right.
Out of now.
edified and sanctified be his great name in the world which he has created according to his will. May you establish his kingdom in your life during your days and during the life of the whole house of Israel, even swiftly and soon and safe. Let his great name be blessed forever and through all eternity. Blessed, praised, and glorified. Exalted, extolled, and honored. Magnified and lauded be the name of the Holy One. Blessed is he. Though he be high above all the blessings and songs, praises, and consolations which are uttered in the world and say, amen. May there be abundant peace from heaven and life upon us and upon all of Israel and say, amen. May he who makes peace in his high places make peace upon us and upon Israel and say, amen. Yikadah, Yikadash, Shmerah, Be'amra, Rakhuete, Yomli, Nahuete. Lakayakon, Yomakon, Ukaye, the Korbe, Israel, Bakala, Ulas, Marin, Kari, Memru, Amen. Eishmerah, Yorah, Be'aram, Olme, Amaya, Yiparak, Yishtarak, Yipar, Yipaman, Yase, Yidar, Yale, Elah, Shmerah, Kusha, Yishu. La'alami, Ka, Bukhata, Yishvata, Tushka Kata, Kata, Amar, Amavin, Emru, Amen. Yehesha, Yemar, Yavar, Yin Shemaya, Yehayon, Elena, Yehakol, Israel, Emru, Amen. Ose Shalom, Yeruma, Kuya, Se Shalom, Elena, Yehakol, Israel, Emru, Amen. If the children will come to the front, and Robert,
I was so nervous.
I didn't do the liturgy. Talk about nervous. All right. Look at all these beautiful children. All right. So we'll all raise our hands toward the children and bless them. Wow, that's a lot. Adonai, bless these children, Lord. Let your word go forth to them, Lord. Let your light shine to them, Lord. Let them be obey their teachers. Let them listen and hear your word and act upon it accordingly. But we just thank you, these children. We love them, Lord. Messiah, whose name we pray. Genesis 47, 28 through 50, 26. Now Jacob lived in the land of Egypt for 17 years. So the days of Jacob, the years of his life, were 147 years. As the time of Israel's death drew near, he called for his son Joseph and said to him, "If I found favor in your eyes, please put your hand under my thigh and show me faithful kindness. Please do not bury me in Egypt. When I lay down with my father, you must carry me out of Egypt and bury me in their burial place." So he said, I myself will do according to your word. Swear to me, he said. So he swore to him. Then Israel bowed down to worship on the head of his staff. After these things, someone told Joseph, "Behold, your father is sick." So he took his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim, with him. When someone told Jacob, saying, "Behold, your son Joseph has come to you," Israel summoned his strength and sat up in the bed. Then Jacob said to Joseph, "El Shaddai appeared to me in Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me. He said to me, 'I'm going to make you fruitful and multiply you and turn you into an assembly of peoples, and I will give this land to your seed after you as an everlasting possession.'" Amen. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu toret emet. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the Torah of truth and has planted eternal life in our midst. Blessed are you, Lord, giver of the Torah.
contractual portion comes from 1 Kings chapter 2. The blessings are on page 69 to 70 if you're sitting or up on the wall. Baruch and I in the Kawa, a sheriff carbon being Kilbin, but it's Abba Ibrahim, Hanayim Rain, Bayamet. Baruch Atad and I have a care public care by Tarah, Uma Shayabdo, of Israel, Uvin B.A. Hayim and Pacific. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King Dean, for who selected the prophets and was pleased with their words, which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, Lord our God, who chose the Torah, your servant Moses, your people Israel, and prophets of truth and righteousness.
Amen.
1 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. Now when the time of David drew near to die, he charged his son Solomon, saying, I am going the way of all the earth. So be strong and be a man. Keep the charge of Adonai your God to walk in his ways, keep his statutes, his commandments, his ordinances, and his decrees, according to what is written in the Torah of Moses, so that you may succeed in all that you do, and wherever you turn, so that Adonai may fulfill his word, which he spoke concerning me, saying, if your children watch their way, to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, you shall not lack a man on the throne of Israel. Moreover, you shall also know what Joab, son of Zechariah, did to me, what he did to commanders of the armies of Israel, to Abner, son of Ner, and Amasa, son of Jether, whom he killed, shedding the blood of war in peacetime, and putting the blood of war on his waistband and on his sandals on his feet. So act according to your wisdom, and let his gray hair not go down to Sheol and Shalom, but show kindness to the sons of Barzillai, the Gileadite, and let them be among those who eat at your table. For they befriended me when I fled from your brother Absalom. Also behold, you have with you Shimei, son of Gera, the Benjamite from Bahudim, who cursed me with a grievous curse on the day I went to Mahanaim. But when he came down to meet me at the Jordan, I swore to him by Adonai, saying, I will not put you to death with the sword. Now don't let him go unpunished, for you are a wise man, and you will know how to deal with him, and bring his gray hair down to Sheol with blood. Then David stood up with his fathers and was buried in the city of David. The days that David reigned over Israel were 40 years. 7 years he reigned in Hebron, and 33 years he reigned in Jerusalem. Then Solomon sat upon the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was established firmly. Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam. Zor Kol HaOlamim, Tzadik B'Kol Pachuk, Hayel HaNeman, HaOmer Ve'Yoseh, HaMdibirim Chayim, Shekol Devarav B'Met Mazedek, Ne'eman Tahu Adonai Eloheinu, V'Ne'evanim Dibureka, V'Nevarekat Dibureka. Akor Lo Yishu Breikam, Ki HaMelech, Ne'eman Baraka Manatah, Baruch Atah Adonai Hayel HaNeman B'Kol Devarav. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, faithful in all generations, the trustworthy God who says and does, who speaks and makes it come to pass, all of whose words are true and righteous. Faithful are you, Lord our God, and faithful are your words. For not one word of yours is turned back unfulfilled. For you are a faithful and compassionate God and King. Blessed are you, Lord, God who is faithful in all his words.
Mary Grace. Today's Brit Hadashah reading comes from 1 Peter 1, 3 through 9.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua,
in the words of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Yeshua, the Messiah. In his great mercy, he caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Messiah Yeshua from the dead. An incorruptible, undefiled, and unfading inheritance has been reserved in heaven for you. By trusting, you are being protected by God's power for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. You rejoice in this greatly, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. These trials are so that the true metal of your faith, far more valuable than gold, which perishes through refined by the fire, may come to light in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Messiah Yeshua. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you don't see him now, you trust him and are filled with a joy that is glorious beyond words, receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your soul. ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהינו מלך העולם אשר נתן לנו חלבך האמת וחיי עולם נתה בתוכנו. ברוך אתה אדוני נותן הברית הקדושה. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the word of truth and has planted life everlasting in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant.
All rise as we return the Torah to the Ark. Thank you.
kids turn away from their faith by the time they get into college. So I really feel like it's important. You know, faith comes from hearing and hearing the Word of God. So we try and focus on the Word of God. These slides I'm going to have for you today, it's a lot of scripture. Hopefully I can put it all together and it'll bless you. And obviously,
amen.
Without the Holy Spirit, the Ruach, it won't matter anyway. So, you know, the Parsha is Vayiki, and because, you know, this is Rabbi's favorite Parsha, I'm only going to touch on it a little bit, you know. I don't want to ruin that for him. I'll let him share his wisdom with you on that. So basically, the goal of this whole teaching is going to be looking at the patriarchs and the things they went through and the promises that they were holding on to and some of the decisions they make throughout these, like Abraham and Sarah, you know, some of the decisions you see them make. You wonder, what the world were they thinking? Well, you got to understand, you know, from their perspective, we get to look at it behind after they've already done that. And a lot of it had to do with these promises that the Lord made to them. So basically the whole idea is that the whole of Scripture gives an account of a elaborate plan set in motion by our Creator to redeem the relationship lost through the sinfulness of men. Although this plan was set in motion before the world began, we will begin looking at the promise given to the patriarchs. It's kind of interesting, though, even though I said that, if we go all the way back to the garden, we can see that situation where the serpent came to Eve and said, "Hath God said that you can't eat of any tree?" You notice he was very subtle in saying, "Any tree, you can't have any tree." And she corrects him. But then it was funny when the Lord did speak to Adam, he said, "In that day that you eat of it, you will die." And it's interesting when you read commentary, and they'll say, well, obviously they didn't die that day, so it's got to be some sort of spiritual death. But the reason I bring that up is because all throughout Scripture we see that these days are really a period of 1,000 years. So technically, in the day that Adam did eat it, how long did Adam live? 930? So in the day, in that 1,000-year period, he did pass away. And I think the reason he brings it up so early on is you'll see even in Peter where he talks about how the Lord is not slack concerning his return. Know this, a day is like 1,000 years. And so you go, oh, okay, in his perspective, we have 6 days where we get to do things kind of on our own with his guidance. And then on the seventh day, his son will rule and reign. And that's the fulfillment of the Shabbat. And so we see these things. And so when you look back, this promise that Abraham has is almost 4,000 years ago. And so we sit back and go, wow, you know, that's a long time. But really, truthfully, it's only been a few days, according to the Lord. So I thought that was interesting. You know, that here, and then even Hebrews, it says that before the foundations of the world, we were written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Everybody here, if you're a believer and you trust in Yeshua, your name was written before the foundations of the earth. So with all that said, let's get into the patriarchs and how they received the promise. And I'm just going to read the scriptures, and then, like I said, the Word of God is more important than anything, I would say, you know, sharper than any two-edged sword, separating soul and spirit, bone and marrow. So we'll read plenty of scriptures, so if I bore you, at least you'll have the benefit of hearing the Word of God. When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and I'll multiply you exceedingly." Then Abraham fell face down and said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram, but you will be called Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations." I've got two different computers going on, this and that. "I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I will make nations of you. Kings will descend from you, and I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you." Okay, so basically, he's been given this promise, first off, that he's going to have these descendants, and all the nations of this earth are going to be blessed by him. But here he is, he's 99 years old and he has no children. Can you imagine being 99 years old and trying to have children? I mean, and that kind of In that kind of setting, people have numerous children. I know now, you know, I can remember when me and Carrie first started having kids, we only had two. And I can remember being Chloe and Josh in the shopping cart, and I pull up next to somebody like, geez, how many kids are you gonna have? Can you imagine in that day and age and not having any children at all, and then be 99 years old, and then hear God saying, it's gonna be numerous as, you know, the sand of the sea or the stars. So putting that into perspective, it was probably pretty hard for him to understand how that was going to happen. Here's the story. Okay. Now the Lord attended to Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. So Sarah conceived and bore a son to Abraham in his old age, at the very time God had promised him. But Sarah saw the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had bore to Abraham, and was mocking her son. And she said to Abraham, expel the slave woman and her son, for the slave woman's son shall not share in the inheritance with my son Isaac. It's interesting, and we'll go to the verse here in a minute, but in Galatians, Paul brings this up and uses it as an allegory. And he basically says that you have Sarah and Hagar, and these are two covenants. And a lot of times, especially in traditional Christianity, there's a misunderstanding there that somehow the Torah is not for us today, and somehow it's been done away with, and that this new covenant is Sarah, and that's the promise. But really and truthfully, if you look at the book of Galatians, it's very easily understood by the first couple chapters. And basically, if you read the first couple chapters, Paul says that he was very zealous for the traditions of his father, and that he understood all the things that they had to teach, but that he came to the conclusion that it was only through God, a relationship with God, and the Word of God that is really the way we should walk. And so when you see this allegory, think about it. Abraham and Sarah are 90-some-odd years old, right? God says, I'm going to bless you, you're going to have a lot of children. Well, what's the natural response? You know, well, how's this going to work? So then you start thinking on your own, and you say, well, we've got to kind of do this. And you don't allow it to be a miracle of God. It's got to be what we do, right? And so he says, oh, well, maybe the Lord meant to have a child with one of these younger girls. And so what do? They grab Hagar, and then they end up having a son, Ishmael. And then later on, God's like, no, this is going to be something that's outside of your hands. And so when we look at what Paul's saying there, It's very clear that salvation can only come from God alone. There's nothing that we bring to the table concerning salvation. But as far as the Torah, that's our obligation as believers, how we walk out our faith. It has nothing to do with salvation, but it does have everything to do with our walk and whether or not we're going to be blessed in this life. And so the next verse you see right here, I guess apparently I might have seen it work this. Okay, here we go. Okay, tell me, you who want to be under the law, do you not understand what the law says? For it is written, Abraham had two sons, one of the slave woman and one of the free woman. His son by the slave woman was according to the flesh, but his son by the free woman was born because of the promise. So we see here that the flesh is what accomplished the first one. That's stuff we bring to the table. But the promise is just like the promise we have in salvation. There's nothing we can muster up to do to make the promise happen. And that was just like Abraham and Sarah. They were 90 years old. They had no way of accomplishing this on their own. And that's a perfect picture of salvation. So I did want to bring that up because I just thought that was a great point. Sometime later, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, here I am, he answered. He said, take your son. And I want to stop right there. Does anyone here have a Stones Bible? Anyone read out of Stones? Okay, you'll notice that Stones is the only translation that actually allows the full translation. The full translation is this: not take your son, but please take your son. Every other translation that I'm aware of has omitted please. It's only one other time in the Torah. So it's interesting to me that they would negate please. I don't know why, if it was just a scribal error or what it was, but when you take that into account and I share that with people, it brings a whole different connotation, doesn't it, if he said please instead of take your son? Okay. Your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will show you. So Abraham got up early the next morning, saddled his donkey, and took along two of his servants and his son Isaac. He split wood for a burnt offering and set for the place God had designated. I'll figure it out sooner or later. Sorry. Okay. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. I want to stop right there too. Probably a lot of you Torah students are aware of this, but that phrase in the distance, that can actually be a period of time if you look in your lexicon. So it's not just this idea of something far off, but something far off in the future. Okay. Stay here with the donkey, Abraham told his servants. The boy and I will go over there to worship and then return to you. This is where Yeshua brings up that situation. Your father Abraham was overjoyed to see my day and saw it and was glad. The understanding is that when he saw that far off in the distance, that was Abraham seeing the accomplishment of Yeshua. And Yeshua is bringing this up to the leaders. And then they basically mock him and say, you're not even 50 years old and you have seen Abraham? He says, truly, truly, I tell you, Yeshua declared, before Abraham was born, I am. Another kind of interesting thing, I think might be the next slide. Has anybody, when you hear Yeshua speak, I remember when I grew up in traditional Christianity, they would bring up things like, when they asked John the Baptist, who do you say you are, right? And they said, are you the Messiah? And he says, no, I'm not the Messiah. Or are you the prophet? He says, no. Well, then tell us who you are. And I can remember people explaining to me that when they said, are you the prophet, they were basically just saying, well, are you a prophet? You know, if you're not the Messiah, then are you some run-of-the-mill prophet? But that's not what they were asking. All you Torah students know that basically whenever Moses said, there's a prophet like unto me who's coming, in him you must shema, right? And if you understand, you go back with Moses. Moses had this unique relationship with God because basically he spoke to God face to face directly as a friend does. You know, and it even says in Scripture, why did you not fear mocking Moses? For he had a relationship with God like nobody else. So when they asked him, are you the prophet? They were basically asking, are you the prophet Moses spoke of that we're to listen to? And so I thought that was really interesting. If you start to understand Scripture, you start to get a better idea of what's being said. In this particular verse in Daniel, who here heard him say, the Son of Man, the Son of Man, the Son of Man? And that was always explained to me as, well, that's the human nature of Yeshua. That has nothing more to do. But really, it is a part of the human nature, but this is the verse that he was basically, he's basically, just like he said, I am, he's saying, the Son of Man, okay? And so, this is the actual scripture where it says, in my vision in the night, I continued to watch, and I saw one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. And he was given dominion, glory, and kingship, so that every people, nation, and language should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. And if you do get into the Gospels, you'll hear him. What is this Son of Man he's talking about? And the sad thing was, is these people weren't in the Scriptures. That's why they didn't understand when he said the Son of Man. You know, in the passage with the woman with the issue of blood, you know, we wear tzitzit a lot. I see a lot of you guys wear tzitzit. Whenever I go to the grocery store or something, we'll have some, you know, cashiers. What's the deal with that whole thing? And you're like, well, it's tzitzit. And they go, oh, okay, whatever. And I'll say, well, have you ever heard of the woman that had the issue of blood that touched Yeshua's garment was healed?
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's what she grabbed onto. And then the next thing we'll say is, well, oh, so if I grab onto that, I'm going to be healed? And I'm like, no. There was a scripture where it says that the one there's one that brings healing in his wings. Well, that's actually a mistranslation in English. It actually, there's healing in his fringes. So see, that woman was in the scriptures, and she understood that this is the Messiah. There's healing in his fringes. So when she went and grabbed it, she was exercising her faith. And a lot of times when we read these scriptures and you see these people not recognizing them, it's simply because they weren't in the scriptures. And that's ultra important for us to be in the scriptures, because, you know, there's a day coming where it says the whole world's going to be deceived. And I think it's going to be because of the lack of truth. This is the actual passage where he brings up the same exact phrase. So that you know it's talking about Daniel 7. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give off its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. At that time, the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven. So that's what he's saying. A lot of what Yeshua said was, if you're in the scriptures, you'll know what I'm talking about right now. If you don't, then you can go back to sleep. Sure.
In that previous one, it doesn't say the Son of Man, it says the article is different. Is that correct? Because you see in the next one, it says the Son of Man, they're different.
Yeah, but in this particular Son of Man right here, if you go back, what does it say about him? He was given a dominion and glory and a kingdom, and that every people and language should serve him. And his dominion is an everlasting dominion. So unless we would have, I get what you're saying, but this Son of Man right here has an everlasting dominion.
I mean, I don't know. I'm asking.
Yeah.
The Son is
I understand.
The Son is different.
Sure.
Talking about the Son.
Sure. Well, then you just direct him to, well, this particular Son of Man has an everlasting dominion. Every person is, you know what I'm saying? And he's able to approach the ancient of days. So, you know, we're getting into English as well, too. We're sitting here choking over English words as well, you know, so.
Yeah, I just didn't know if that was the
correct translation. Sure. Sure. We're not going to go into question and answer, but we'll go ahead and finish.
I'm sorry.
Because she was barren, and the Lord heard his prayer and his wife directly conceived. But the children inside of her struggled with each other, and she said, "Why is this happening to me?" So Rebecca went to inquire of the Lord, and he declared to her. Two nations are in your womb, and the two peoples from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger. It's interesting right here. You'll notice that Isaac didn't try and do what his father did. You know, they had the same situation. They weren't able to have a kid, but he waited and he prayed. I think, you know, probably his father said, "You know, son, don't make the mistake I did. Just go ahead and wait on the Lord, and he'll bless you." And so she has this situation, and she's given the wisdom that the older will serve the younger. And if you look at some of the things Rebecca does, the Lord appeared to Isaac and said, "Do not go down to Egypt. Settle in the land where I will tell you. Stay in the land as a foreigner, and I will be with you and bless you. For I will give you all these lands to you and your offspring, and I will confirm the oath that I swore to your father Abraham." So he gets the same promise. "I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give them all these lands. And through your offspring, all nations of the earth will be blessed, because Abraham listened to my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws." Now Rebecca was listening to Isaac, told his son Esau. So when Esau went into the field to hunt game and bring it back, Rebecca said to her son Jacob, "Behold, I overheard your father saying to your brother Esau, 'Bring me some game and prepare for me a tasty dish to eat, so that I may bless you in the presence of the Lord before you die.' you know, the situation, it looks very deceptive, but we've got to understand that Rebecca was given wisdom from the Lord, that the older was going to serve the younger. So I think this is just another case of where somebody in the flesh is trying to accomplish the things of God, and she's like, wait a minute, my husband's about to bless the older, when really the Lord told me that the younger was to be blessed. So I think this is just a little bit of her trying to step in the Lord's place, and we're all guilty of that. And this is basically what she tells him. Now, my son, listen to my voice and do exactly as I tell you. Go out to the flock and bring me 2 choice young goats, that I may make them into a tasty dish for your father, the kind he loves. Then take it to your father to eat, so that he may bless you before he dies. Jacob answered his mother, Rebekah, look at my brother Esau as a hairy man, but I am smooth skinned. What if my father touches me? Then I will be revealed to him as a deceiver, and I will bring upon myself a curse rather than a blessing. His mother replied, your curse be on me, my son. Just obey my voice and get them for me. So basically what I'm trying to do, I know this is a lot of scripture, and you know, I was sitting here thinking, is this too much? Is it not enough? I'm basically trying to show that these people had a couple promises they were holding on to, and everything kind of hinged around these promises. They had the promise of the land, and they had the promise that all the nations of the earth were going to be blessed by them. And so I'm showing through all the patriarchs these blessings that they were given. So bear with me on this. And Jacob had a dream about a ladder that rested on the earth, and its top reaching up to heaven. And God's angels were going up and down the ladder. And there at the top, the Lord was standing there saying, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you now lie. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west, to the east, the north, and the south. All the families of the earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. So he gets the promise as well. Now we're actually getting into Vayikhi a little bit. When the time drew near for Israel to die, he called his son Joseph and said, I have found favor in your eyes. Put your hand under my thigh and promise me that you will show me kindness and faithfulness. Do not bury me in Egypt, but when I lie down with my fathers, carry me out of Egypt and bury me with them. Joseph answered, I will do as you requested. Swear to me, Jacob said. So Joseph swore to him, and Israel bowed and worshiped at the head of his bed. You can notice that the major issue that Jacob has is that he wants to be buried in the land. And that goes back to the promise that was given to their family. They were to be in the land. I can't help but think that maybe there was something going on with the resurrection, you know, their hope for the resurrection, that they wanted to be in the land when that happened. And that's why it was such a big issue. But do you guys remember when Joseph has a dream that really his brothers weren't too thrilled about? And then he had another dream where it said even the sun and the moon bowed down, and his father kind of got a little, he said, what, are me and your mother going to bow down? This is the passage right here where he actually bows down. You see right there, bowed in worship. Okay, and I think there was something a little bit more there than him just bowing down before his father. I think the issue is that it's kind of a picture, because we know this, that Messiah, and Rabbi did the teaching, what was it, Miketz, there's chock full of ties between Yeshua and Joseph. And you'll notice that in this situation, right before Israel is coming into the land, he asks to come into the land. If you understand that Israel's been scattered and they're slowly but surely coming back to the land, and then ultimately, Paul tells us in Romans that when all of Israel comes back together, then Messiah will come. That's kind of a picture here of that situation where Israel is finally bowing down to Messiah, because there's plenty of people in Israel that don't understand Yeshua as the Messiah. But when they all come back into the land, the unity, that's when they'll understand that. So that's kind of a nice little hidden thing of the last days of when Yeshua and Israel. Jacob said to Joseph, God Almighty appeared to me in Luz in the land of Canaan, and And there he blessed me and told me, "Behold, I will make you fruitful, multiply you, I will make you into a multitude of peoples, and I will give you this land to your descendants after you as an everlasting possession." So he's continually like, this is what your grandfather, you know, your great grandfather, all the way down, this is the promise we have that we're waiting on. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "I'm about to die, but God will surely visit you and bring you up from this land he promised on an oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." And Joseph made the sons of Israel take an oath and said, "God will surely visit you, and then you must carry my bones up from this place." So Joseph died at 110. They embalmed his body and placed him in a coffin in Egypt. So see, this is even Joseph's concern that he wants to be taken back into the land whenever they go back. Now we get into Hebrews. Okay, now looking at all the patriarchs and their desire to be in the land, the promise that was given to Abraham, the descendants blessing all the earth, Hebrews 11 does a wonderful job of kind of explaining some of this stuff. Now, faith is the assurance of what we hope for and the certainty of what we do not see. This is why the ancients were commended. Okay, they were commended because they didn't get to see any of it, really. When you think about some of the stuff, you know, the most, what, Jacob had 12 sons? I mean, can you imagine? You know, they lived their whole life, lived to be 100 plus years and never saw it. By faith, when called to go to the place he would later receive as an inheritance, obeyed and went without knowing where he was going. By faith, he dwelt in the promised land as a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him on the same promise. They're holding on to the same thing like we just saw. For he was looking forward to a city with foundations whose architect and builder is God. By faith, Sarah, even though she was barren and beyond an opportune age, was enabled to conceive a child because she considered him faithful who had promised. And so from one man, and he was good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people died in faith without receiving the things that were promised. However, they saw them and welcomed them from afar. We see that a little bit of what happened to Abraham seeing Yeshua. And they acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. Now those who say such things show that they are seeking a country of their own. If they had not been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac on the altar. He who had received the promises was ready to offer his one and only son, even though God had said to him, "Through Isaac, your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead, and in a sense, he did receive Isaac back from the dead. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning the future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons in worship as he leaned on the top of his staff. There we go again with the worship. By faith, Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites and gave instruction about his bones. So basically, Hebrews 11 does a really good job of kind of condensing everything we just talked about. And I guess the reason why I'm trying to bring, this is what I felt led to talk about. You see these patriarchs, they have this promise, and then Hebrews even goes on further and says that not only was this promise about this physical land or this descendants, but it's about a heavenly, a kingdom that is not of this world. This is one of my favorite passages because those of you that know my testimony, I grew up in having a name Noah Zachariah, my brother Elijah Moses. We grew up with the understanding, you guys must really know the scriptures. And unfortunately we didn't because my father was very, he was a street evangelist. He would go out and share the gospel. We constantly, when we were young, I don't remember much of it because he passed away so early, but he would bring strangers to our house. that you find on the side of the road, share the gospel with somebody. Who's this guy, you know? And he unfortunately passed away when I was about almost 3 years old. And so my mom kind of went through this stage in her life. Here she's in her early 20s, got two boys. Instead of running to the fellowship, now I don't know what her fellowship was like, whether or not she was plugged in it or not, but basically she basically turned to the world a little bit. And so we always had that prayer, you know, pray over dinner, you know, pray before you go to bed, but there was never any real study. And so to give you the short version, because some of you have heard this, I met Carrie, who's my high school sweetheart, and she started inviting me to church. And we went to a church that really didn't read the Word of God much, so I was like, well, this is kind of boring. But, you know, in respect, you know, I felt like, hey, you know, I've got to respect this. You know, this is the Lord's Word, and this is the Lord's place. And so for years, she kept trying to give me Bibles, and I can remember she'd have queued up in the radio when we'd get in the car, and be like, some praise song, you know, be queued up so I'd listen to it as I'm driving. And went through all these things, but we finally went to a church that was teaching the Bible. And so as you start hearing the Word of God, that's why, you know, I probably overdid it on this one, but it's like the Word of God changes people.
Yes. Amen.
And so that's the ultimate goal, you know, is for people to be changed, to be encouraged. And I remember she joined this woman's Bible study and it started getting real serious. And I was like, I'm not comfortable with this anymore. We're not just going to church on Sunday. Now you want to go on Wednesday night and join all these extracurricular stuff? And I said, well, I'll see you on Sunday, but you can have the rest of it. And I had respect, but it was not in me to do it. And so finally, I think after about a couple of years, come to find out this woman's Bible study, they were praying for me. And she came home one night, and I was just sitting on the couch, and, you know, the typical, hey, how was it, you know? And she looks at me, and she said, how do you know that you're in the sign now? And I said, well, I gave the canon answer. Well, I believe that Yeshua died on the cross for my sins. And she goes, do you think the demons believe that? And I got kind of upset, like, you're going to call me out like this, you know? And so I kind of gave her a little bit of attitude. And then she, I said, well, what do you want me to do? And I kind of said it, starting up and just with the end of the conversation, what do you want me to do? You know? And she looks at me with authority. And this is why scripture is so important. She said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things will be handed unto you, Noah. And I crumbled. I never cried in front of this woman. I crumbled right there off of one verse, Matthew 6:33. And I went barreling in the back room. And she's chasing after me, telling me she's sorry. I'm sorry, I'm sorry. And I was like, I don't even know what's happening, but I can't deal with this. I gotta go back in the room. Well, that weekend she was going on a long women's retreat. She bought me this Bible I never opened. I ended up reading half the Torah from Friday evening to almost Sunday, and then went to church that weekend. And I've never been the same. I love reading scripture. It's not that I've never made any mistakes, but after that one verse, I went from going, yeah, that's great for you, but it's just not for me. From that to boom. And this verse right here, I never even read. I didn't even know John 3:16. I knew Adam and Eve, Noah, and Yeshua died on the cross. That was it. And so when I saw this, I was like, this is what happened to me. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, the leader of the Jews, who came to, well, Jesus, like Yeshua at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. Yeshua replied, truly, truly, I say to you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he's born again. How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Can he enter his mother's womb a second time and become born? Yeshua answered, truly, truly, I say to you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of the water and of the Spirit. Flesh is born of flesh, but spirit is born of spirit. Do not be amazed that I said you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes. You hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it is going. So is everyone that's born of the Spirit. That is what happened to me. I realized after it took me, I think, because see, I was reading all the Torah, and then somebody said, no, you're reading it all wrong, which that can be disputed now. You need to read the Gospel of John. And so when I got in here, I was like, this is what happened to me. I had already had my physical fleshly birth, but I hadn't had my spiritual birth yet. And it happened by one verse. When Yeshua was confronted by Pilate about his kingdom, Yeshua answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now, my kingdom is not of this realm." This is what we try and focus with the youth, is that there is this kingdom that's coming that's not obvious to everyone they come around. But if you stay in the Word, and I think that the issue with staying in the Word is it's an eternal book. It talks about eternal principles, whereas all you're going to get today in social media and all that is basically, what does it say in the Epistle John? Says, the love of this world is, what is it? It's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the, yeah, exactly. And you look at it, what do people post? Well, look at me, look how good I look here, and hey, happy holidays. I just left my garage door open where you can see the cars I got in there. And so we focus on those things so much, and we don't think about the eternal. And even us, I can say right now, when I'm not in the Word, I become fleshly. When I'm out in my car, I'm not loving my neighbors myself, you know, and when I'm doing things. But when I stay in the Word, when I start in the Word in the morning, and when I try and focus on those things throughout the day, those eternal things, then everything goes smoother. And that's kind of the focus that we try and do in the youth is, hey, guys, stay in the Word. You know, have a regular time of study. Stay fellowshipping with other believers that can build you up. And that's something we can look at. You know, we need to focus on that. We need to think about the fact that this promise of this kingdom that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that's the same promise that we're holding to. You know, that we're a part of that. Through Messiah, only through Messiah, are we able to be Abraham's seed. Right? Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off every encumbrance and the sin that so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race set out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Yeshua, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such hostility from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. And this is the promise in Galatians. You are all sons of God through the faith in Yeshua Messiah. For all of you were baptized into Messiah, have clothed yourselves with Messiah. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Yeshua Messiah. And if you belong to Messiah, then you are Abraham's seed according to the promise. And that's pretty much what I wanted to focus on, is that through Messiah, whether we're Jew, Greek, free or slave, we get to be a part of that promise. That is how the promise was, as much as the sand of the sea, as much as the stars of the sky, because it encompasses all of us through Messiah. And how many here know that throughout the volume of the book it's written of him, right? That's why, because if you think about it, what is the scripture? The scripture is showing us our condition and how God's going to fulfill that. So ultimately, it has to be about Yeshua, because there's no way we can do anything without him. And so that was the focus. I know it was a lot of scripture, but I really wanted us as believers to think about, as we go through these partials week after week, that we understand that we're a part of that. Just like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that God's plan, we're a part of that. From the foundation of the world, as we're written in the Lamb's Book of Life, through all the lessons we learn from the patriarchs and from the prophets and from Messiah and his disciples. And now here in front of us, we have an opportunity. There's, you know, in the book of Hebrews, it says that your habitation came from the Lord. He puts us in certain spots. I mean, you think about it. One of the big promises they were holding on was living in a certain spot. So it's like Ivan has somebody, Robert has somebody, Stan has somebody that we're put around, and it's up to us if we sow to the flesh. We're going to reap corruption in front of them and not be the witness we should be. But if we sow to the Spirit, then we're able to have that opportunity to share with one another. And that's ultimately the goal, right? Because
yes.
That promise is sands of the sea, stars in the sky. That happens through us being a part of God's plan as well. So, I don't know, they said last time, I didn't speak long enough. It's 3 minutes to noon.
You're awesome.
I feel like that's pretty good. So, thank you guys. Like I said, it was a lot of scripture, and hopefully it's a blessing to you. The famous clickers.
In the name of Yeshua, our Messiah.